So a very warm welcome to a presentation that is delivered here at the VCS through the Agile Methods Specialist Group in collaboration with the PMI UK Charter. So, we keep seeing a set of challenges in the program management, in the project management office, generally speaking, throughout the hierarchy of project management. And these particular issues could be addressed with really good principles and techniques introduced through Kanban. The vast majority of the techniques, the practices, the approaches, particularly focus on the team, the very people's centric, the very team oriented, and actually, we can't find similar techniques and similar approaches at a program level, at a portfolio level, that have the same rigor, the same robustness. First of all, let's see how many of you guys work in an IT-related department? Okay, and what about non-IT? That's it. Okay, that's more or less representative, generally speaking, in any audience, given the topic. So, lack of robustness, lack of rigor, and on the other hand, what we see is a lot of spreadsheets, a lot of Gantt charts, a lot of internal memos that I don't think you are very much in favor of them. Is that right? Who loves spreadsheets? Okay. Who loves, I don't know, endless status update calls? You, Jose, really? Okay. So, we're introducing some Kanban ideas just to help the PMO. And let's start with some provocative questions just to set the scene. If you want to interrupt him at any moment, please be my guest. But I can assure you, they are provocative. Right, so can we deliver true business value faster? And you can see the big fat asterisk here. So, can we deliver value faster, with more transparency, more visibility, and more predictability across the entire organization, across the portfolio? Do we need a budget want in order to achieve this? What is the right approach? So faster means that we focus on the business, the value-driven activities, the business activities that actually meet the goals from a strategic point of view, they meet our objectives. So it's all about valuable work that benefits essentially the end user. Why do maturing companies face issues with productivity, quality, morale, and time to market? And there is a word here, maturing, but I must assure you that I've been in mature organizations that have been around for approximately 120 years, and we don't have the rigor in the project management. So can we make our environment, our workplace, a little bit more fun? Can we create an environment that is truly creative and collaborative without fear? And that's important in project management. Why do product development projects miss their economic objectives? Is it because we miscalculated the net present value? Is it because we were a little bit optimistic in putting together the return on investment? Or did we disregard completely all the raw data from the market, from our internal team, from the teams outside our colleagues? We disregarded completely the data from the frontline employees. Do we suffer by output myopia? So, let's face it here. are drowning in waste. So can we decrease wasteful activities for 15%, 20%, 50%, 98%? Is this possible? How many meetings have you attended that were not productive, that did not add value at the end of the day? Do you spend time dealing with your inbox rather than trying to get a project update from that's realistic? So can we offer any key takeaways so you can start thinking on the way home about small improvements in your PMO? So let me introduce myself at this stage. My name is Lazaro Wolf. You can follow me on Twitter at Lazaro Wolf. With Jose and Victor Page, we are the founding partners of a new agile consultancy in London, Actinium.io. You can visit our website. Our public schedule for courses is going to be online very soon. And your hashtag for the big fat bird here, Twitter, is hashtag Kanban PMO. So, are you ready for this, guys? Great. Let's go for it. We found that the vast majority of the issues in the PMO would be identified based on the strategy that organizations pursue. And the vast majority of the times, organizations like ours adopt these strategies either unconsciously or consciously. And it has to do whether we are implement systems with pull or push strategies. So before going further, let's see how many of you think that you work in an organization that is implementing push strategies. Okay. What about pull strategies? All right. And the people that did not raise hands? Okay. We'll see what's going on a little bit later. All right. So, I think, you know, the people who actually raise their hands in a pull strategy organization, I must admit, you are absolutely lucky to work in such an environment, but we'll see if that ticks the boxes in the definition later on. Generally speaking, in a push environment, we can feed the organization with a lot of projects. Essentially, we constipate the organization, this for a better word, with a lot of work in progress, with a lot of projects in progress. Whereas in a pull organization, we value work that gets complete, work that gets done, and we pursue on other work initiatives once we have the capacity, once we have the capability to do so. For example, Jose recently attended an organization that had 95 different projects in flight with just 20 developers. So this is absolutely crazy, isn't it? But isn't this the reality of the workplaces we are working for? And sometimes we just focus in a false way on the delivery throughput, and we accuse who else? Developers. We say that either they're slacking or either they are not engaged and motivated the way we expect them to be. So what we do instead, we all hear now this magic word, agile, and essentially we bring in the agile sort of soldiers, either agile coaches or agile trainers. So PMO people, program managers, portfolio managers say, all right, we need to pay for an agile trainer, they're going to come in, they'll make my team agile like this. Really? Is this the approach? Instead, we don't focus on the root cause of the issue, which is too much work in progress. let's dive a little bit deeper into the definition of what a push organization is. Essentially, decision making takes place in isolation. So in high-level roles in top and senior management, without any input from frontline employees. Absolutely, they have their opinions. Absolutely, they have to use their experience in order to smell the strategy of the business. But is this enough without raw data? Is this enough without feedback loops directly from the end users, directly from the customers? Not only that, they make these decisions, and the decision-making process is absolutely invisible from the rest of the organization because they think that it's not important for them to explain. They set unclear expectations and goals, and that creates a divide between the organizations. Most of the times, employees, yes, they produce output that actually meets the organizational goals. However, there's a lack of motivation, a lack of engagement, because there is fundamentally a misalignment between the personal interests and the organizational interests. There's a divide between us and them. And here, as program and portfolio managers, how many times you have to face with a situation like this?
Sorry. In an environment where cost reduction is a matter of survival and meaning, I'd be interested in understanding how Kanban can make the frontline people welcome the redundancy notices. I mean, don't need to answer at the moment, I'd be very interested in how it goes on, but I think that's been a reality check here. Yeah? The fact that, you know, okay, we may be entering a whole new world of GDP growth and the cycle changes. And for the last few years, an awful lot of programs have been about driving costs out of the business. And a lot of the people you're talking about are the ones who are actually on the victims. So I'd be interested to see how that works.
Kanban, generally speaking, introduces good visibility, good transparency and predictability in a system. And if we try to map our entire organization end-to-end from ideation to actual post-deploy phase in DSDN, after the delivery phase, there are many opportunities to streamline processes further, have multiple reality checks. If this is sort of the drive or the motivation for redundancies and cost reduction, possibly. But I don't think that we work in organizations that innovation and knowledge work and creativity can be sort of met by existing personnel, by the existing headcount. In my limited experience in comparison to so many of you here, I've been in organizations that the headcount was always short because there was not cost minimization, but sort of a maximization of existing resources or existing people, trying to achieve the most with consultants that it was more than evident that they should be dramatically more. Not sure if I answered your question.
We all have different experiences.
Okay. Let's share them. Through the press. Any other comments about that? Do you agree? Do you disagree? We can make it very interactive if you want. Okay, so so I was saying that yes, we might drive organizational results at the end of the day, but there is unhappiness and dissatisfaction in the environment. There is lack of economic prioritization of the projects, and there is misalignment in strategic goals, and this is because the message of why we chose this project over the other is not clearly communicated. And there is a sort of a vicious circle, especially in a push organization. Employees resist any sort of change, any sort of new management policies, any direction that creates discomfort, and management pushes a little bit more. And you get more resistance to change, and they push even more. And that creates, generally speaking, an unhappy environment that is not particularly empowering. It's not enabling our colleagues, our employees, to really unleash the best of their potential. On the other hand, in a poor organization, we have the following. Teams manage themselves, they self-organize, they control their capacity and their capability, they know where expertise lies, and they know whether they're able to manage more work. They're equal contributors into their problem-solving process, absolutely, and in the decision-making process as well. They commit to this voluntarily. They raise their hands and they say, look guys, we have more capability to support more work. So they commit to that in comparison to something that is forced, something that is pushed to them. So when you have this sustainable environment, essentially we have happier employees, more engaged, with more passion and excitement. And more importantly, in a poor organization with poor-based systems, you have predictability. It's something that is data-driven, it's something that can be skewed by what a project manager or a program manager can tell you. The data is there, you know exactly where that particular work package, what particular project is going to go through the system. And at the end, there's a very smooth journey from ideation to the actual completion, given the fact that our entire organization could be mapped very effectively in a very systemic manner through Kanban. So I asked at the very beginning, do you still feel that you work in a poor organization? What about in a push organization? What about the rest? Okay. So, in our example today, we are going to have a look as the DSDM as the project lifecycle. We try to combine the best attributes of the DSDM process lifecycle as the enterprise project management framework in combination with a very distinctive approach of the Kanban method that is dramatically more lightweight. Nevertheless, it produces transparency, visibility, predictability, and visualization in the entire hierarchy of the project management at the team level, at the program level, at the portfolio level. So we harnessed the best of the two worlds, combining and you see the results very, very shortly. So the first step is really to visualize DSDM, and this is the new version that was introduced in May 2014. So is to map the existing process into a Kanban board. So have a look. Here it is. So first of all, let me caveat this. We found it particularly appealing just to change the tickets as they go through, as they flow, as we say, through a Kanban board. And we did that just to highlight the state of the given projects. However, the type of the tickets doesn't change through the Kanban board. And also, let me bust very quickly another myth that surrounds Kanban. Kanban is not a board. So if you see the initial inception of Kanban, as described by David Anderson in the Blue Book, is essentially a system, a pull-based system, without a board at all. So it is possible to implement a Kanban system without the visualization element. However, we'll see how powerful this can be in a few moments. So you see here that it's absolutely cramped with work. And this is how a company that I recently visited looked like, absolutely cramped with work. So in this slide, let's simplify it a little bit and let's investigate together the best attributes of visualization. So, first kind of practice, let's visualize our existing process flow. First, you don't need a spreadsheet anymore. I know we have some spreadsheet lovers over here, but you don't need a spreadsheet anymore. It's very easy to get an accurate state of your project through a Kanban board. It is possible to identify your projects that are actually blocked. Why? Because they bear a visual aid, and that could be a red circle, a red rectangle, something that, you know, is visually irritating. Essentially, you can go there as a program manager, as a portfolio manager, and say, okay, I need to step up. I need to go deep into that particular team, that particular project. I need to enable my employees with a tool, maybe with my political capital, maybe with another maneuver. I need somehow to help facilitate the resolution of this blocked project. Also, it's very good to follow some rules across the entire portfolio when a project is really, really blocked. When do we raise the hand and say, this should be red? The other thing is we raise awareness of the bottlenecks. So going back to the Kanban board, do we have a bottleneck here in the foundation phase? Do we have a bottleneck in the delivery phase? Do we need to hire more people? But please be careful about the mythical month. And again, we've been in organizations that they had project teams or business analysts that were too few just to support the velocity of the entire organization. So hiring was one of the options. Align projects with teams. And sometimes this is very straightforward because a single team is aligned to a particular project. Sometimes we have individuals. In professional services organizations, we have the so-called shared resource model. And we have multiple assignments. We have a person in more than three, four, five, up to 15 projects, I personally observed. So this gives us a very good sense of the existing workload. You can resolve interdependencies very nicely, again, with the power of visualization by using graphical aids. On physical boards, I've seen people really connecting two tickets with a red stream. And believe me, that really works because it's there, it's physical. Another thing that we borrowed from Kanban and Lean is a prioritization based on pure economic techniques. Is it cost of delay? Is it cost of carry in retail and in banking? Is it real options? Is it another alternative economic driver behind this? And finally, we classify the projects by the nature, by their nature, using color. So on the top of each column, we introduce this red circles. And these red circles are work in progress limits. Essentially, we introduced the concept of WIP, work in progress, or PIP, projects in progress, in order to create a pool-based system. Otherwise, without WIP, you don't have Kanban. You have just a board, which is very useful. It is an information radiator. But by introducing work in progress, this is how you truly establish a pool-based system. So what are the merits? Let's have a look. First, you give the ability to the teams to balance, to reconcile, essentially, their work with their capacity to deliver quality products. So going back to project management, Agile Project Management 101, essentially, iron triangle, the non-negotiable variable there is quality. So we fix that in Kanban and in the DSDM process lifecycle as well. WIP limits create a coordination mechanism. So we can see whether there is some capability in delivery, so we can pull, essentially, another project from foundation. Or if we want to deploy something, if we have the capability, again, we pull it from delivery. That creates really a true sustainable pace in the organization. Right? Nobody is pushing anymore, but the interactions, project delivery, program delivery, portfolio management is delivered in a very productive and sustainable environment. Essentially, WIP is WIP limits are signals for availability, and they expose the issues. So in the case of a bottleneck, through the information radiator, through the actual Kanban board, it's very easy to identify these issues, these bottlenecks. Also, it's very easy to identify availability. And finally, we focus on how projects flow through the system, rather utilization. And that leads very nicely to this quote by one of the masters in leadership. Unfortunately, he died a couple of years ago, Stephen Covey, who said that, avoid futility of endless busyness. Make time to renew. Find time gaps to reflect. Take advantage of Slack to respond to change. And more or less we know that. In order to respond to change, especially in an agile environment, we need to have our retrospectives. We need to sit down, talk about it, identify all these procedures or processes that need improvement, apply a change management initiative, go forward. But do we do that at the PMO? And I would like actually to get back to you. Do we do that? Do we really stop and think all the root causes of the issues in the PMO? What do you think? Shy or so economies of scale is an absolute myth. Economies are in the flow. That comes from a British organizational psychologist John Seddon, who supports that. So let's see why. First of all, in a flow management system, you manage your portfolio with variable data. Everything is data-driven. Prioritization is made on economic drivers, on economic principles, rather than opinion, rather just through experience, which again is important. But what will happen if we marry opinions, the gut feeling, experience and raw data? I suppose that the result is going to be fantastic. we do have the ability to identify and manage different types of projects. We have 3-month projects, we have 3-year projects. How do all this flow through the board? Is it possible? Yes, it is. We can distinguish the projects between internal and external by using, again, color rays. We can apply different rules on every single project. And more importantly, it enables us to further understand, to deeper understand our PMO through good sort of data analysis and data representation techniques, such as accumulative flow diagrams or lead time distributions. All these provide you with bottlenecks, provide you with good predictability. All the issues are exposed. So I wonder whether we are ready for that kind of problem exposure at times. But organizational life is not always just projects that have been meticulously scheduled, vetted through good business analysis. We have some projects that are absolutely uncertain. That's why we introduced the expedite lane into the Kanban board. And this expedite lane allows us to, first of all, break the WIP limits, and it gives us the opportunity to really focus all of us collectively in a very collaborative fashion on the business critical project that just emerged. It gives us actually the means to respond to that. And it allows the entire organization, again, from end to end, not just delivery, not just the project management office, but including HR, including finance, including marketing, to really look over a particular expedited project and say, guys, this is business critical, let's do something about it altogether. Essentially, it gives us, it enables us to act on time. So, further, and you see every slide we add another little piece. Essentially, that, by the way, the slides are going to be uploaded on SlideShare. We'll send you the link later. What we follow is a very basic change management process of how you could potentially introduce a Kanban system into your PMO. So far we talked about visualization, then we talked about WIP limits, the expedite lane, and now we go a little bit deeper into the delivery phase of DSDM. So we visualize and manage team workloads. Essentially we have, or we will have, nested delivery boards. And these delivery boards could be Scrum, could be Kanban, could be even Waterfall. In a professional services organization, it could be anything. It doesn't matter. However, we still have the nice visibility at the PMO level. We actually focus on completing projects. We have the WIP limits. We have the visual irritation of so many projects that come in. Very recently, I read an article about gov.uk that explains a particular motto that these teams have. And this is, no new features, no new projects. It's essentially, take what you have now, migrate to the new platform, and make it, deliver it at the best of your ability. Innovate on what already exists there. Someone would say this is exactly the other extreme. Absolutely. But again, Kanban allows us to focus on just completing work. We also avoid project multitasking. We focus on the bottlenecks. We focus on the project in question, rather having all the issues between switching contexts. And of course, it's very easy to coordinate multi-project deployments. So here, we were placed at the development column, essentially the little cards with the actual delivery method. And as I mentioned, that would be Scrum, that would be Kanban. We can really provide at the PMO level a granular level or a granular view of what's going on at the team level. And that can happen instantaneously without spreadsheets, without visiting the team. Of course, we always encourage face-to-face communication. We encourage collaborative activities. However, we live in a world that is distributed nowadays. We have audio and video conferencing. We have distributors in low-cost markets. So by having all that kind of valuable information at that granular level, I believe it's very important for the management of your PMO. Also, priorities change, the business environment change. Essentially, we live in a fiercely competitive environment, business environment there, that influences our priorities in the backlog. Shouldn't these changes be visible at the PMO level? Here it is, they can be visible now. Now, from a change management point of view, there is, let's put it mildly, some reluctance of Scrum teams to adopt something that preaches flow instead of velocity. So we believe that this approach will have them on board very, very quickly. So it's very Scrum team friendly, that approach, because their delivery model is not going to change. It's going to be depicted into the Kanban board. So the tickets in this board form the sprint goals and essentially the sprint backlog stories and the potentially shippable increments from the Scrum teams contribute towards their deploy phase. Another good, really good principle of Kanban is to establish policies, certain rules between the different columns. It is very similar to the concept of the definition of done. So we have a ticket from doing to done. We need a rule for that. So here, essentially we say to put explicit policies when we move a project or a program from one column to the other. I'll give you an example. A policy for moving between visibility and foundations, according to the DSDM process lifecycle, that should be, we need to complete an outline business case or a risk assessment, outline solution, maybe a working prototype or a feasibility prototype is really optional, so we can skip that. Outline a plan and project approach questionnaire. All these need to be done before moving anything from feasibility to foundation. So you can avoid this hassle of going back to your teams and try to see, to check whether they adhere to your policies, to your rules, and whether they jeopardize the quality standards of your organization. Do you have any questions so far? So that leads us to why. Why are we doing all this? Why software and product development is so badly handled by some? That requires essentially separate measures throughout the project management hierarchy. Why is so disconnected? It's almost ineffective, and for some is utterly broken. What is the reason behind that? So we tried formal project management, we tried risk management, heavyweight processes like the capability maturity model, tried lightweight process management such as agile, and we tried to create leadership in our organizations. So why does it keep failing? And essentially, why it matters most? And from our perspective, it matters for this guy, and that girl, and that guy, and that lady there. And essentially, they are all interconnected. And what I'm talking about is essentially our people at all the levels of hierarchy in our organization. And they're all interconnected through the talent network. And by the way, I'm talking about people, not about resources. People with a heart and potentially a pulse. So our people have to be creative. They have to be interested. They have to be curious, empowered, in order to be motivated and committed. And one could say that all else that we talked about tonight probably will pale into its significance if people don't take center stage in our PMO. So whether you classify your organization as a machine or a political system, as an organism or a flux in transformation, and this is Morgan's metaphors in change management, whether you like to focus on design and process re-engineering, which is fantastic, but is a very top-down approach, whether you perceive your company as a political system with coalitions forming and trying to negotiate and maneuver, trying to overpower other coalitions that will, in order to support their interests. Essentially, what matters at the end of the day is how we roll out changes in our PMO, or particularly the Kanban system that we presented tonight, by overcoming issues and putting people, as I mentioned, at the center of the stage. So, I suppose you are familiar with the J curve? Yes? No? Okay. So, essentially, Kanban is one of the best and most popular methods because of the very easy introduction to an organization. So from a change management point of view, resistance is very low because we start with the very humane, let's keep doing what we do now. Let's focus on what we are doing, let's improve it. So in organizations that have DSDM as your process lifecycle management framework, your projects, the introduction of Kanban is very easy. And you go through these different phases from the late status quo, resistance, chaos, integration, and new status quo very, very easily. Why? Because of the collaboration, because of the participation of the employees. of our colleagues. So let's have a look at static, who is the change management approach, change management implementation method of Kanban. And static essentially stands for systems thinking adoption with the introduction of Kanban. So first we need to identify some sources of dissatisfaction. So do we have a rough idea what the problem is? Do we have sort of the scope of this change management activity? Have we identified all the stakeholders that they need to participate in this? Is it just the stakeholders within our teams? Is it stakeholders outside our system? Is it also the customers? And finally, what about the rest, the wider organization? Have we adopted a systemic approach to this? Next is demand and capability. Are we ready to understand what to really answer the question, what we do to whom and why? Do we have an idea about how work flows from one boundary to the other? Have we mastered the mechanics? At the model workflow level, if you adopt the DSDM process lifecycle, it's already there. The next step is really to define classes of service. And you can use that as an internal tool to schedule and organize work. Or alternatively, you can use it as a different approach to manage client expectations. Essentially, you classify your projects through these classes of service, and everybody has specific expectations. Whether it is a fixed day project, whether it is an intangible project, such as maintenance and support, etc. And finally, when you are about to design your Kanban system, how to scale the success? Are you going to be a big bang implementation adopter? Or should you try to roll out the system to a very small team or to a very small program, learn from it, and essentially scale the learning outcomes across the entire portfolio and the entire business? Also, some things to consider is physical versus electronic. Are we all co-located, or do we have distribution, so an electronic medium is very much needed? And finally, don't forget, we put people first. We need their feedback. We need to keep them engaged, informed, and use their creativity as much as possible. So, yes, we have many mechanisms for reviews and retrospectives, and that kind of feedback loop meetings at the team level. What about the rest of our PMO? Between team level and program level, between program level and portfolio level, and all the other combinations in between. Let's think about it. That's it for tonight. Thank you. Questions?
You mentioned, coming back to your point about this radiator and board for Kanban and do not use Excel worksheets, what will be your suggestion for PMO, which usually should provide a lot of reports for top managers? What process should be used or techniques could be used to transfer such walls, information, into reports?
That's a really good question. And I think that senior managers are very used to reports with a lot of data, actually we question whether that kind of data is useful to them. So essentially a snapshot of a Kanban board, or a very lightweight version of it with very short narrative, it appears through our experience that is enough for senior top management.
But from practical point of view, what type of tools you are using or could suggest?
So there are quite a few tools out there that create this hierarchy of project management there. So you have the team level, the program level, the portfolio level. I can share a couple of names in private, not in public, but there are some tools out there that actually tick the box.
And following your answer, maybe in this case, if you should use some tools for reporting, maybe it's better to not use such board on the wall, but from the beginning to use these tools to track Kanban activities and to use automatically reporting rather than fill data from the wall into the system. This is the point I'm trying to clarify.
Sure. I'd say that it depends on the organization we are talking about. So it's the size, it's the nature. I've been in a startup quite recently that they prefer to have physical board because they could have these high-level talks at top management by just sitting in front of the board and talking about it.
It's a question about one small point at the beginning when you mentioned the different kind of teams. It's about the self-organizing teams. Actually, my question is not provocative at all, but have you really seen self-organizing teams? How does it go, really? Because it looks to me like a kind of ideal or dream organization, but I never really saw that.
I'd say that it's fair to admit that self-organization in absolute terms, as we read it in textbooks, is very hard to achieve. However, is an incremental and continually improving process. So we're putting the idealistic sort of target on the wall, and we say we want to be like this. I'd say it's a journey to infinity.
Okay, so maybe what stage have you actually seen, or would you see as an optimum working, let's say, a realistic approach from your experience?
There are teams that have been working together for several years, more or less a decade, and you see the traits of the self-organizing team there. Of course, it's people that have been working together for so long, they know how they respond to change, how they behave, what their approach to decision-making is. Essentially, they've reached forming stage in the Duckman model just because they worked themselves as personalities within the team.
Let's say even in a small startup, let's say you have always the founder or CEO, even if everyone is coding and working together. So how do you see that track?
That's an interesting one because, again, it depends on the personality of the founder or the CEO. In the startup environment that I've been, the founder had very dominant personality, right? And some would say that this is fair, right? It's the idea, is the risk, is the realization of what he had in mind. Fantastic. I think it requires a lot of courage within the team to say that we appreciate you are the founder, we appreciate you are sort of a distinguished member. However, are we collaborating at the same level? And once he realizes that they need to form a team without a hierarchy, but they truly support a common goal, this is where things start to get better. Otherwise, there is a vicious circle, a continual clash between them.
Be self-organizing team plus kind of leader.
If the leader can be a part of the team, that would be fantastic. So everybody can feel that they are their leader in their own way, in their own capacity.
I think one of the most interesting things you highlighted was you need to come back to.
Sorry,
can you speak up so that people can hear you?
I'll do my best.
Okay. Well, you repeat.
Maybe you can repeat back because you've got a better voice. I think most interesting was you highlight that you should come back to reality check the business that actually you can't do 20 things across just 4 engineering teams.
Sure.
And I'm guessing the rules were very useful because that then forces people to go back to the 20 things they've been asked for and pick the 4 things they really want. But maybe you could. That all sounds looks great on PowerPoint, but in reality, that's quite a challenging space. So, what sort of frameworks do you see put around that to force those conversations to come to a good end? Because I can see worlds where there's 20 stakeholders with 20 ideas, mm-hmm. and they all think they're really important, and they all have to go now. And why they'll come here, and then you come in and you face into that conversation. So, I'm interested in how you do that.
Sure. Did we hear the question? Okay, so I believe the question was, please correct me if I'm wrong, that in the case that we have 20 different stakeholders, how do we operate within the WIP limits? How do we sort of choose which project is going to get more priority than the other? Because there's a cut off point. For example, at delivery, you put a WIP limit of 3, which means that just 3 projects need to be in flight. Just 3 projects need to be worked by the delivery teams. So what happens if we have 20 projects and multiple stakeholders that fight for it? I'd say that we have business prioritization meetings. But every single stakeholder needs to come in. They have to justify why a particular project needs to be prioritized higher than the other. Essentially, we have a leader or a board of leaders that make such decisions.